So, Akisandira sets the stage for the conversation we are just about to have. Let me paint the picture for you on what exactly is happening in that region. So, the other day, Deputy President William Ruto was actually on the ground, and this bandit started shooting a few meters from where the Deputy President was. As a matter of fact, there's a chief who was killed just meters away from where the Deputy President was. And there is concern because we're getting reports that people are being killed. And it's not just any other person. There are women involved. There's a couple of days old child who was also killed in this conflict. And so the question is, what exactly is ailing that region? Are the leaders doing each and everything they can to put an end to it? What exactly is the national government doing about this? Because security is a national government concern. So let's have a conversation with three gentlemen in studio with me. I'll begin by introducing them. My extreme right, I have William Cheptumo, Member of Parliament, Baringo North, sir. Thank you so much for joining us on KTN Prime this evening. I have Kagongo Bowen, Member of Parliament, Marakwest East. Sir, thank you so much for joining us. And of course, we have Professor John Lonyangapuo, West Pokot Senator. Sir, thank you for joining us on KTN Prime. So allow me to begin with you, Professor. Where exactly is the problem? What is happening in that region?
Thank you, Linda. And thank you for inviting us to come here today. What is happening in Baringo, and in particular Kerio Valley, is not very good for all of us who are Kenyans, because lives are at risk. Some people have been displaced from their homes, and there is mayhem everywhere. We have almost the four communities. We have the Marakwet, where my brother comes from. We have the Tuken. We have the Ilchams, who are also a small community in Baringo, and the Pokot, who stretch all the way from Tiate, which is Pokot East, to West Pokot County, where I come from. Mm. So the insecurity that is seen and witnessed there is not good for anybody. And personally, we know where the history began. Problems have been in that part of the world for a mighty long time. But this time round, they became excessively more. Why? Because of the drought that we have. The Pokot are primarily pastoralists. And in East Pokot, the area where these pastoralists stay, for the whole of last year, there was almost no rain. So this year with this drought, as is usual when there is a mighty drought, the pastoralists look for pasture. Incidentally, our two neighbors, the Marakwet, they are in a better place, and the Tuken, they are in a better place. So that's what happened. So the pastoralists migrate looking for water and pasture.
So when you say they're in a better place, that does mean that
there's water and some little bit of grass.
So that means the community, Pokot community, is now looking for pasture.
Exactly. And then that's the time now you'll see a lot of pastoralists and herdsmen migrating to save their livestock from destruction by the drought.
Okay.
Yes. Even the Turkana, it happens like that. They are devastated. Okay. The Samburu, also our neighbors, devastated. Now, when they arrive and they visit my neighbors who are farmers, that kind of a conflict is expected. That is where now the provincial, it used to be called provincial administration, and the leaderships that are concerned should be able to sit down and see how they can manage the process of these strifes that have arrived.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mheshimiwa, is it just about pasture? We're seeing women and children getting killed. Has it crossed the red line, so to speak?
Thank you, Linda. To me, I want to disagree with Professor.
Okay.
That it is an issue of one community being a pastoralist and another community being farmers. We have quite a number of pastoralists in this country. We have seen pastoralists in some other parts of Northeastern, in coast, and even outside Kenya. In Tanzania, we have a lot of, the Maasai's here, pastoralists also. But they don't kill people. They don't kill people. To me, what's happening in Kerio Valley is, one, I can attribute that they are, the Pokot community is like, they are expansionists. They want to expand their territory. Number two, there is a commercialization of cattle rustling. there must be people who are behind somewhere who are taking away these animals. Why is it that when animals are taken away, in the shortest time possible, or you follow the following day, even the policemen, they can't get. There is a case in my constituency where some animals were recovered in an auction in Laikipia. So I can say there are people who are benefiting from this cattle rustling in Kerio Valley.
Okay, we'll ask Mheshimiwa if the POCOS are trying to expand the territory. Mheshimiwa, what are your thoughts?
I completely disagree with the professor.
Okay.
Because his argument is that the conflict is occasioned by search for pasture by the Pokot community. Far from the truth.
What is the truth then?
The truth of the matter is that there is very clear intention actioned by that community to not only take away the livestock from the community of the Tuken, but to also expand their territories. And I will explain, and I really believe that my brother professor will really be honest.
He's here, he will ask him everything.
If it is about pasture and water, what would have happened was that the leaders and the elders and the people from the Pokot Nation would have come forward, approached the people from the Tuken side or the Marakwet side and say, look, we have a problem. We have our livestock, they need water, they need pasture. That has been the cultural practice between the Tukens and the Pokots over the years. These are people who have lived for very, very many years as neighbors. Now, how then does it become a pasture issue when they raid communities, drive livestock, burn houses, kill people? It changes the concept completely from the concept of pasture to a different concept altogether. And so my argument is that it is important for us as leaders, beginning from me, beginning from the professor, that for us to get a solution to this problem, we must be able to converse and agree the actual, the real causes of this problem.
Okay, so let's agree on what the real causes are.
It is not just about pasture.
Okay.
And in any event, even when there is pasture in the Pokot side, there are normal days when there is drought, certain months of the year. But even when there is plenty of water across the communities, when there is plenty of pasture across the communities, killings continue,
okay,
and the issue of livestock being taken.
So
the theory of pasture and water is misleading. And it's true, it cannot be the real reason why.
Professor, your theory is being disputed.
Linda, I am sorry that I am seated with men who are simply lying. The narrative of expansionists, I want to request Kenyans to dispel and refuse it completely. How would you expand land when Kenya today has title deeds? Mm-hmm. I want to ask you. Mm-hmm. It doesn't. You know, I will start with Marakwet.
Please.
We have permanent and pensionable river called Kerio. You don't cross across. So East Pokot, do not cross the river. As God lives, how he gave us that river as the beacon and the border, nobody's
Christ. No, I have no idea.
Kangoko should tell me, how do you expand water? How do you expand the river? What happens for him, because of drought, there are only two active rivers in the entire Tiati constituency, Kerio, and another one where we have to trespass to Baringo, Arabal, on the other side, and the river comes from Laikipia. When there is a drought, even River Maya, which comes from Samburu, dries. So right now there's no water completely in the entire Pokot side.
Okay.
And there was an agenda by these people of Baringo not to give those people water. How do you give people water? You make boreholes. How do you give people water? Dams, especially when they are pastoralists, from time immemorial. So they continue to run for refuge to God-given water. Now, as soon as they reach with their cattle to the river, some notorious boys from Marakwet begin to shoot anyhowly, because when they see cows coming, they think there's an invention.
Notorious boys from Marakwet.
We have also bandits.
Okay.
I can assure you, we have terrible bandits from this side, and they know it. Okay. They have even killed people. We were buried 2 days ago.
Are there bandits from your side as well?
Yes. You know, we are bandits. We have to accept. That's why we have this problem.
Okay.
So we have this problem. So I want to say, issue of expanding land, sorry. Because land, government has demarcation. You know where it ends.
So that's...
Linda. So wait, it will be, you'll be given time. And there are people who are behind this business of cows. A thief is a thief. Whether they eat those cows or they sell, we have mechanisms of tracing them. They should actually be, they should not entertain that, because if you want to get cattle that has been stolen, we know how to trace the market, isn't it? But who is selling? How would you, I mean, you expect somebody that the people are funding it. Suppose those bandits die, will you get the cows?
Washing your...
Linda, what the professor is saying is actually, I can say it's far from the truth. All Marakwets, including is in your records, including the 2001 massacre in a place called Murkutwa massacre, the Pokots crossed the river. They killed more than 60 Marakwets in one morning. The same year, during the polio vaccination in Tow Trading Center, almost 15 children were shot and killed by Pokot bandits. Can you tell me? What do you call that one? Can you say that the Pokots, they were coming to look for a pasture? They crossed the river to Tot is about 15
So what I'm getting from what you're trying to explain is that the Pokots are the aggressors.
They are the aggressors across the Kerio Valley. The idea that they are coming for a water and pasture is neither here nor there. I want to ask the professor. Professor is here. And he's a professor, mathematics professor. The reason, one of the reasons why there is still that continuing issue in Kerio Valley, and even generally in Pokot land, is also development. There are very few schools in the site of Pokot. There are no developments going there. Professor is seated here telling us that now these people are pastoralists. They are going to be pastoralists and killing people up to when? You are a professor.
And that is why we need to have solutions. Mheshimiwa.
Now, it may be very easy to justify the boundary between the Marakwets and the Pokots because of the River Kerio. For me, in Baringo North and Baringo South, because I want to address the situation in both Baringo North and Baringo South. We don't have a river separating the Pokot people and the Tuken people. Mm. We have our boundaries that was demarcated long, long, long time ago. Our elders know, the elders of the Pokot know, our fathers know, their fathers know.
Okay.
It is everywhere, even in our maps of this country. Now, I still want to address this issue. When professor says it is not possible to expand, we are not talking of physically expanding land. That is making the argument to be very narrow.
Mm-hmm.
We are talking of the Pokot people expanding their territory from where they ought to be.
Okay.
In this particular case, for example, Linda, and I want to be very clear because we are talking about facts. If it is not about expansion, if you exceed your boundary with your livestock to look for grass and water, it means therefore when there is rain, it should go back because there will be water and pasture in your side. But then how do you then cross over the boundary? You begin to settle down, mm-hmm. build your houses, burn the houses of the neighbor, the next house, build your house there, turn some of the schools from the Tuken into where your cows actually stay.
See.
They are in Baringo South, for example.
Yeah.
And these are real issues. And they are not issues, Linda.
And you see, that is what concerns me, is that I have three of you seated here, representative of the people, and you can't agree on where the problem is.
We will not agree, Linda, because you don't agree with lies. These are facts.
So can we put the facts on the table and agree Baringo where
South.
The problem is?
Baringo South, for example, up to a place called Araban and beyond, that area from 2005 have been occupied by the Pokots. Living there, building houses in
right,
their livestock.
So I need to...
Baringo North, for example, as I finish that point, from a place where we border, they have moved to settle all the way to a place called Loruk and other areas. So I think I want to be very clear, and Kenyans are watching us here, my people, our people, because we are one family of Kenya, are watching us. It is... The concept is make the Tugans poor by taking away their livestock, expand your territories, occupy land, and control. It's a good case, Linda.
All right, I really need to take a break.
If you have a location, for example, called Mukutani, from independence, mm-hmm. that has been a location that is being manned by Baringo South people. But today you confer the name from Mukutano to Mukutani, to Mukutano.
Right.
And then you have a chief on top of that location.
I need to take a break. Professor, trust me, I'll give you the right of reply. So we need to take a break here on KTN Prime. In just a few minutes, I'm trying to see if I can get the gentleman to agree, first of all, where the problem is, and second of all, if there are any solutions whatsoever, and look at the solutions that are being put on the ground by the government. Are they long-term solutions, short-term solutions, and what are we looking at? Because you have families who have been displaced, you have people losing their lives as well. Stay with KTN Prime.